I'm old-fashioned. I like two sexes. Yeah, and another thing, all of a sudden I don't like being married to what is known as a new woman. I want a wife, not a competitor. Competitor, competitor.
Talk about a bit, this crying in the morning thing, this depression, you know, let's get that fixed.
That's what men think, isn't it?
What?
Unless you've got the answer, unless you can say, oh, I know this bloke in the Essex Road who could fix that, then there's no point bothering.
How do you rate women so well?
I think of a man, and I take away reason and accountability.
I love him. I love him, and I don't care what you think. I love him for the man he wants to be, and I love him for the man that he almost is.
What do people have rows about?
Money, sex. Sex, money. He wants, she doesn't want.
She wants, he doesn't want.
Women have always been a big problem to me, Dr. Fussband. Are you listening, Doctor?
Yes, go on.
Dr. Fussband is my hero. I have finally decided. Hi, everybody. It's the male-female hour. We suspend news reporting every Wednesday, second hour of the Dennis Prager Show. I'm Dennis Prager, if I didn't say that already. And we devote the hour to the great questions of male-female, men-women relations. We try to be as honest as possible, which therefore causes some degree of pain. But I try to do it as gently as possible. And the reactions have been wonderful, hence we continue this show each week. Now it's a couple of years. Now, today's show, I have a guest. I had this woman on when she first wrote about this subject, that I will introduce in a moment, in an article in the Atlantic Monthly. And I had her on. She has now expanded it to a book. She's now working on an encyclopedia. She is expanding it to an... Actually, no, she's expanded it to a book titled Marry Him, The Case, which is, I think, the name of the article, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough. Yep, for Mr. Goodenough, The Case for Settling. And it's written by a woman you wouldn't expect to have written it. It's not written by a woman with conservative credentials. Rather, she's, in fact, a frequent commentator for NPR's All Things Considered. And I don't mean National Prager Radio, but rather National Public Radio. And she's written for the New York Times, Atlantic, Time, People, Slate, Self, Glamour, Elle, Salon, LA Times, etc. She is Lori Gottlieb. And the book, indeed, is Marry Him. On the jacket, it is noted that NPR said, Lori Gottlieb didn't want to take her mother's advice to be less picky. But now that she's turned 40, she wonders if her mother is right. So, Lori Gottlieb, welcome back to the Dennis Prager Show.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
I appreciate that. First, after the article, I am curious, were you, because I suspect you're very honest, were you semi-deluged with emails from men?
You know, I was deluged with emails from everybody, but I was really interested that the men were writing to say, you know, thank you for writing this because we have so much trouble passing muster with women that, you know, women will rule us out for all these different reasons for just a second date. You know, it's not like you have to decide you want to marry the guy, but they won't even go on a second date with guys for really trivial reasons. And a lot of guys have, you know, had a hard time out there in the dating world for this reason.
Now, is it, it's really good to have you on the second time because now you have all of the reactions and perspective on the consequences of your article. So, first of all, do you think there's a symmetry? In other words, would there be just as much a need for a book, Marry Her, The Case for Settling for Ms. Goodenough?
I think we're all Mr. and Ms. Goodenough, and that's the point. My book is not about settling, meaning lowering your standards. My book is about everybody needs to have high standards. Everybody needs to have chemistry and physical attraction and connect emotionally and all of those things. But the problem is that a lot of us in our culture today have high standards about the wrong things. So we're too picky about the things that actually aren't going to matter in terms of finding lasting love in a long-term relationship, but we're not picky enough about the things that we should be looking for that are going to matter.
Now, before you give us some examples of each, you realize, and I want to know how you deal with this internally, you realize that you are essentially offering a conservative message here.
I don't think it's a conservative message. I don't think it's liberal or conservative. I think it's common sense.
Well, I think conservative messages are common sense, but that's my bias. Okay, that's fair enough. But
it's not. It's not about. It's not. It shouldn't be so polarizing. It's really saying, look, if you want to get married, and if you want to have a certain kind of monogamous, long-term, loving, fulfilling relationship, and you're wondering why you haven't been able to find that, I was wondering too. And so I went out, I'm a journalist, and I went out and I tried to find the answers. When I wrote that Atlantic piece, somebody wrote me this email that was so telling. She said, you know, I understand that we shouldn't be looking for the perfect person. I'm not looking for the 10. In fact, an 8 would be great. But I'm already dating an 8, and what if I want a different 8? And that really is what I try to answer in Marry Him, which is, you know, what does it mean to be realistic in a way that will also make you happy? So, you know, I go around and I talk to experts all over the country in fields ranging from, you know, neurobiology to psychology to sociology to behavioral economics, and I really try to clergy, and I really try to get some answers on what it actually means. And what I'm saying isn't shocking. It's more that it's about a change in perspective in our culture and how the things that we think are going to be important are actually not the things that are going to make us happy.
So your appeal, which makes indeed perfect common sense to me, is it's not that one, I go back to your prior statement, it's not that one should not have high standards, it's that you should have high standards about the things that matter to a marriage.
Exactly.
Now, what are they? What are they?
Well, you know, a lot of times people think, you know, let's say that they have a very, like a chemistry of a 9 with somebody, and they think that they're very compatible with that person, but really they have probably a compatibility of a 5 because they think, oh, we're so compatible. We, you know, we both watch the same TV shows, and we both are, you know, we
love
both
Chinese
like
food. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right. And we like the same restaurants, and you know, and he likes this quirky little thing that I like, and you know, that's all great, but that's not what compatibility in marriage is really about. You can find a guy that you have everything in common with in terms of, you know, the kind of, like, you like the same movies and restaurants and you know, all of those kinds of things. But how do you guys both feel about family? How do you guys feel about finances? How do you feel about, do you have the same goals in life? How do you, what are your world views? What are your values? And I think people just assume because they're so in love that, you know, well, of course we feel the same way about all these important issues. But then they get married and they find out 5-10 years down the line that, gosh, we're really different people and we don't look at the world the same way.
Right. So what you're saying is, and I want to be as specific as possible because I think you can help people here and in this particular case, women. So what would you say is on many women's lists that they order strike off, aside from, you know, commonality in food tastes?
Well, I mean, I think the thing is you just don't know who you're going to fall in love with. But a lot of women have this idea of what the guy is like who's going to make them happy. So he's this height and he's this age.
Right. So there's an image. An image stands in their way.
Right, of a type that, you know, and they're like, right. Well, they're not open to any other kind of men, and they don't even get to know them.
When the men wrote to you that they're not even given a second date, why do you think that is?
Oh, this is so funny. One of the experts that I spoke to had done some research on this, and he sent out a survey that said, you know, he asked men and women what would disqualify a person for a second date. And the men said, here are the things that why I wouldn't ask a woman on a second date. If she wasn't cute enough, and by that they did not mean, I want to clarify, that she had to look like Angelina Jolie.
That is very important. I tell this to women all the time. This
right.
notion that men are all comparing the women of their lives, whether their wife or their date that night, to a model in Victoria's Secret is nonsense.
The funny thing is that, you know, men are much more able to separate out fantasy and reality.
Yes, and bravo.
And so men can have these fantasies about Angelina Jolie and Victoria's Secret catalog models and all of that, but they know in reality, like, not one healthy, mature man thinks, oh, yes, I'm going to marry Angelina Jolie or the Victoria's Secret model. Women, on the other hand, look at Brad Pitt, and they're like, I want someone like Brad Pitt. And so they can't separate out the fantasy and the reality. So the survey was so interesting because men said...
All right, hold on. These are gems. Marry Him is the book, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough, and we'll take your calls now on the male-female hour on the Dennis Prager Show. The book is up at DennisPrager.com, the blog area. 1-8-PRAGER-776. You're listening to the Dennis Prager Show, the male-female hour. Some gems are really coming across here from Lori Gottlieb, who has now written in book form what she originally wrote in its nascent form in the Atlantic Monthly, Marry Him, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough. The last points that she made are worthy of their own hours, and I have already done it and will do it again. Women fear that when men look at pictures of women and fantasize, that they're comparing their woman to that fantasy. And I've always told women that unless the man is truly unhealthy, and most men are in the normal range of unhealth to health, just as most women are, that is not what men do. Men compartmentalize. Women apparently, and this is your insight that I did not have, women apparently don't compartmentalize as much. Their fantasy is, you're saying, so often what they want in a man. So if they're crazy about Brad Pitt, they really want a Brad Pitt for a husband. Is that what you're saying?
I think they want, you know, their version of the equivalent.
Yes, obviously,
yeah. And in fact, that what I was saying before is that there's this survey that was sent out where men and women were asked what would, you know, disqualify a person from a second date. And men said, you know, she has to be cute enough. Again, not Angelina Jolie. She has to be warm and kind, and she has to be interesting to talk to. If she's not those things, he's not going to want to go on a second date. Those all seem very legitimate to me. Women gave back 300 reasons why they would disqualify a guy for a second date. To marry him. I mean, just to go...
Is that literally true, 300?
Literally 300. That's what it came back with, yes.
Men gave 3, women gave 300.
Exactly. And what the women...
This is priceless information. Is that in your book?
It's in the book. All in the book. See, the book is not my opinion. The article was my opinion. The book is not my opinion. What I did is I'm a journalist, and I went out and I spoke to all of these people to try to get answers for why all of us women who, you know, we think we're not too picky, we think we're open-minded, and really there are a lot of things that are going on that we don't even realize, and we're actually getting in our own way of finding that passionate, true love that we're looking for. It's, you know, and so the things that the women wouldn't go on a second date for were things like he wore a brown belt with black shoes, or he told this story. And
I'm out. I'd be out. I'll just tell you right now. Go on.
Things like he ordered tap water. literally.
That's pretty serious.
Literally. And you know, they didn't give these guys a second chance. They didn't.
Wait, let me just ask. We have a bachelor here. Sean, do you order tap water on dates? Only bottled. Okay, fine. All right. So you have 299 other reasons to be disqualified.
I'm sure women would find a reason to rule them out for a second
date. 1-8-PRAGER-776 is 877-243-7776. Here is the interesting thing. If you would ask the average American single and perhaps even married person, which sex do you think is more likely to disqualify someone for trivial reasons? 99% would say men do.
Oh, get this. They did a survey about this pickiness thing about the genders, and they asked women and men, if you got 80% of everything you want, is that okay? And women said, no, that would be settling if I only got 80% of what I want. And men said, 80%, that would be a catch. So
that's right.
That's the thing. You know, since when is getting 80% of everything you want? You know, people are not.
Hold on.
Like,
I think we need to play a Jack Nicholson again from the beginning, from the opening. Isolate Jack Nicholson. You can't. I finally found something Sean can't do. Wow. If you can, do it, because I want Lori to hear it, because this is what makes the case where women truly, in this instance, are being less rational than men.
You know, but it is irrational, but I think it's not because, you know, there's something wrong with women. I mean, you know, I'm one of them. So I think it's that.
No, there's something wrong with both of us, but you have to fight your nature. That's all I'm saying. That's one. I mean,
I think that women, you know, when people say, oh, women are so picky, I think it's out of fear. I think it's out of fear that we're going to pick something different from what compares to who we thought we wanted. And if we pick something that's not like the cultural, whatever we've been imbued with culturally of like what Mr. Right is supposed to look like, that somehow we brainwash ourselves and talk ourselves out of even giving that guy a chance.
So you do. You're saying women do that.
I'm saying I think it's out of fear. I don't think it's
out of fear of what? Out of fear of what?
Out of fear of picking. Out of fear of like going against this cultural pressure that has been internalized, which is that, you know, instead of asking, do I like him? A lot of times we sit across from a guy and we think, you know, how does he compare to who I thought I wanted? We're not consciously thinking that, but it's like internally we're thinking that.
All right, look, everybody wants to know, so we might as well cut to the chase here. So, have you progressed in your search for Mr. Good Enough?
Oh, absolutely, and it's all detailed in the book. I will tell you.
She has a smile as she's speaking.
I hear it.
I do.
Can
I
you
heard
you through the phone line.
Well, almost.
It's all detailed in the book. But you know, I think the point is.
By the way, did it emanate from the article?
No. It was actually in the book. I hired a dating coach who was a guy because I wanted a guy's opinion about. I wanted him to reality check with me on, you know, what were the mistakes that I was making? What were some of the things, the assumptions that I was making that were wrong? What men were I not letting into my life who could actually make me really happy? And the guy that I ended up with was somebody who on Match.com, I didn't want to email him because he was wearing a bow tie and I thought that was dorky. And because he was shorter than I would have wanted, and by the way, I should mention I'm only 5'2", and also because he said that his profession was real estate, and nothing wrong with real estate, but I'm a writer, and I thought, oh, I have to have a creative guy. And it turned out that the bow tie story was adorable. It had to do with his grandfather and his connection to his grandfather, and it made me like him even more. And he was, even though he was shorter than my ideal, I absolutely was attracted to him. And the real estate thing, it turned out he was way more creative than I am. He actually went to architecture school and was like designing and renovating buildings.
This is a phenomenally important story.
Right.
Phenomenally,
we make
the number of women who have to hear this is nearly 100% of single women. No, it is. I can't tell you. I'm because all I want to do is good with the male female hour, and you're doing a lot of good with your book and what you're saying. This is huge. Anyway, may I further pose? Do you want to get married?
Of course, I want to get married, but you know, not everybody does, and I'm not saying, you know, a lot of people. If you don't want to get married, this is not the book for you. If you want to figure out how to find the guy who's going to make you happy in a marriage, this is the book for you.
Okay. Well, it's up at DennisPrager.com. It's called Marry Him. Now we'll take calls. Some very important things have been said here, and we're going to have the time. That's the beauty of radio. Not only this hour, but many other hours, the male-female hour, to expound on them. Lori Gottlieb, Marry Him, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough, at DennisPrager.com. And the number is 877-243-7776.
How do you write women so well?
I think of a man, and I take away reason and accountability.
You're listening to the Dennis Prager Show, the male-female hour, every Wednesday, second hour of my show. And, folks, I believe that if you if you have a single woman in your life and you get this person to hear this hour and then presumably read the book, but certainly just even to begin with, just hear this hour, I think it can change a lot of women's self-destructive patterns for why they may be staying single if they actually do want to get married. So I remind you that you can get this hour just by calling 800-225-8584, 800-225-8584, or send an email along, and we'll forward it to them. And remind you, that's why people get Pragertopia to subscribe to this at $6 a month. It's called Pragertopia. It's getting a subscription to the show. You listen anytime, play it for anybody. The book is Marry Him, and Lori, I'm telling you, you have really, really done good work. And I, you know, I have no vested interest in your financial success, except to say that if you succeed, I think a lot of women will be helped there by a lot of men. One is almost tempted to ask you, what awakened you?
I think what awakened me was I realized, you know, I think when you're single, a lot of married people don't talk honestly about their marriages to single people.
Never do.
And
forgive me, Lori, but that is the unique part of the male-female hour on this show. It is honest talk, and sometimes it causes people to be even annoyed with me, but people are afraid. Guys are certainly afraid to. So therefore what? They don't tell honest things to singles, and therefore
I don't think that they really, you know, talk about what, you know, what is important in their marriages and what makes them happy in their marriages and what are some of the challenges that they have to deal with in their marriages. When I talk to married people, you know, I reported this book, so when I talk to over 200 people in addition to the experts, and what people who were happy in their marriages said was, you know, I love my husband because of, you know, all the wonderful, fun things. But what really makes me love him, what really keeps me, you know, day-to-day loving him is how we've gotten through the hard times together. How, you know, like what he's like in the four worst. You know, there's for better or for worse. That's what your marriage vow. But what is he like in the four worst? And when we're dating, it's easy to fall in love with somebody in the for better part. But, you know, what are the qualities that he's going to have so that, you know, in any marriage there's going to be the ups and the downs, and most of it's just in between.
Your story about seeing your guy on the dating service and your three instant disqualifications. I'm serious. I have actually committed it to memory. Dorky because of the bow tie.
Right.
Not creative because of, real estate. Yeah. And he's not taller than me.
He's not tall enough. He was taller than me, but not tall enough, yeah.
Oh, he was taller than you.
Well, I'm 5'2", so
I know. Oh, okay, so not tall enough. Okay, no, that's why I thought you said he was even shorter than you. Fine.
No.
So he's, but not tall enough, exactly. And how you would have missed a terrific guy. By the way, as a man, I was telling my producer here during the break that as a man, a guy who appears on a dating service with a bow tie, I would more naturally be inclined to favor as a man, not for me, obviously, but for a woman, than the guy in the typical jeans and T-shirt. Now, I'm serious, because as a guy, I know it takes some guts to appear different. So he must already have what women do love in men, self-confidence.
He absolutely had self-confidence.
Exactly.
Yes.
But as a guy, knowing guys, I would know that.
Right.
I wouldn't think dorky. I'd think this guy marches to the beat of his own drummer, and is this a guy worth knowing?
Right, and I think unstylish and dorky.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
And I'm not alone in that.
No, that's why it's so important. Let's go to West Houston, Texas, and Christy. You're on with Lori Gottlieb and Dennis Prager. Hi.
Hey, Dennis, what's going on?
You know what's going on. What's going on with you?
I just wanted to say, you know, I really, really, I'm married. My husband got me listening to your show, and it's really, in a way, you've kind of like saved our marriage. And I think that the advice that you give is absolutely wonderful. He listens to it daily. And, you know, I know this is about a single topic, but
All right, hold on. Stay on. I want to get that point. Don't forget, the book is Marry Him. It's up at DennisPrager.com. We continue.
But it wouldn't be nothing, nothing without a woman or a girl. You see,
I'm listening.
Man made the cars to take us over the road. Man made the train.
It's a good one. Good one.
To carry the heavy load.
All right, everybody. Dennis Prager, male, female hour. One that is intended. They all are. All the hours, male, female hour. Indeed, all the hours are meant to positively influence, even change the direction of some listeners' lives. I think that Lori Gottlieb has done a real service here with her book, Marry Him, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough. And you see, some things, it's like men have to hear me because they trust me as a man, and women will trust Lori as a woman. So when you say things that are counterintuitive to your own sex, then you have credibility. And so it's very important here. Let me go back to Christy in Houston, West Houston, to be precise. By the way, do me a favor, Christy. You said that I helped save your marriage. If you could send me an email on how exactly, it will help a lot. It'll help a lot of other people, too, because then I'll know what points I need to emphasize. So what did you want to say to Lori?
Well, Lori, the advice you gave, you know, and I never knew this, because some of the problems that we have in our marriage are to do with, you know, my insecurity because of things that have happened in the past. And you had said that men have the ability to compartmentalize and that, you know, they're not comparing me to, you know, Jennifer Aniston or some beautiful model, that it is just me that he loves. And really, today, it was almost like a big weight lifted off my shoulders, you know, because now I really know that, you know, I'm not being held to that standard. Right. And it's...
Yeah, well...
And not only that, Christy, but, you know, when I think a lot of women expect that especially married women, expect that their husbands are going to, you know, if they're not being, you know, romantic in the ways that, you know, guys in movies are, that their husbands aren't attracted to them or in love with them. And that's just not true. Men show their affection and their love for you differently, and it might not be with a grand romantic gesture.
Well said. And that point about the compartmentalizing I have made over and over, but maybe it you never know what time a person hears it will click. I in this instance, ironically, Lori, you would think that I, as a guy telling women this, they would trust. But in the case of Christy, it was you saying it, which is just great. But women fear terribly when men see pictures, and I'm not talking porn necessarily. Just any, whether, you know, a catalog, a bra ad, a model on TV, and they think, uh oh, he's falling in love with her. He doesn't fall in love with me.
Well, and the reality is, you know, this, again, this isn't my opinion. This is what I researched in the book. And I talked to somebody who actually studies marriage and divorce. And there's a whole chapter about marriage in here that's specifically about what the difference is in terms of women think that, you know, that, like, if they, women are usually the ones who leave the marriages. So sort of like the men are happy in their marriages, and women don't realize that they're the ones who are often dissatisfied. And when this researcher that I spoke to looked at people who were getting divorced, it turned out that the women rated their marriages as, you know, sevens, not like three or four, as sevens.
And how interesting.
They would say things like, I love him, but I'm not in love with him anymore. And the men were devastated because they thought the marriage was just fine.
Right, because they're not asking for as much.
Right. Well, they have high expectations, but they're realistic about
that,
what one
well,
human being can
right.
provide.
Yes, exactly. Well, that happens. Well, look, I don't know if you would agree with me, but men have their battles, women have theirs, and I always say to women,
right,
their battle is to be more rational, because the emotional is so powerful in women, and this is a rational way. A guy thinks, you know what? Yeah, you know what? I'm going to weigh all of the things in the balance, and you know what? It is better to be married.
Well, I think that it's better to be married to the right person. And I think that what happens is a lot of women think that if they leave the marriage, they're going to find something better.
Well,
and what this guy found was that he studied them over 20 years, and every 5 years he'd check in and study them again. They were less happy once they left. Even if they married someone else, they traded in one set of problems for another set of problems.
That's right. Norwood, New Jersey. Frank. Hello, Frank. Lori Gottlieb. Dennis Prager.
Hi, Dennis. Hi, Lori. Dennis, I first just want to say that I you are one of the most even-keeled, level-headed human beings I have ever heard in my entire life. And that's why I absolutely take every chance I can to listen to you,
Thank you
throughout the week. So
I worked at it. Let me just tell you. Go ahead. Go ahead.
About the, it does remind what Lori said about the expectations of women, and it reminds me of a great joke, and it is clean, about a bunch of women going into this new store to shop for men, and it said on the first level, there was they take the elevator to the second floor, and it says on this floor are ugly, poor, fat men. Well, we don't want that. Let's go to the third floor. To go to the third floor, these are average-looking men who are rich. Well, that's better. Let's see what's on the fourth floor. These men on the fourth floor are rich, gorgeous, sensitive, and they have everything going for them. Oh, this is excellent. This is perfect. But wait, there's a fifth floor. Let's go see what's on that. They open the doors and say, there's nothing on this floor. This floor is just to prove that women are never satisfied. And
that's a bitter joke.
But you know what,
wait a minute. Wait a minute. Lori, are you laughing?
That's actually the joke that starts off my book. That's why I'm laughing.
Oh, okay. Fair enough.
That's in my book. So you and I are on the same page.
On the same floor.
Yeah, we're on the same floor, which is the not being too picky floor.
I also think another great point is, and what I realized is, you know, the old saying that men always say, oh, who can figure women out? And I finally came to the conclusion, in honesty, that it's very difficult to figure someone out when they haven't figured themselves out. And I think that that is such a lacking part in both men and women. But I have found it, and maybe, I don't know, call me sexist, but I find it more in women that they haven't figured what they out. And I've met many women and have friends who say, oh, I just want a nice guy. And I've known them for years. And I'm like, no, you don't want a nice guy because you always go out with jerks.
Okay, we'll be back in a moment. Marry Him, the case for settling for Mr. Goodenough, up at DennisPrager.com. This hour really went fast, and if you want a copy of it, either just subscribe to Pragertopia or call 800-225-8584, 800-225-8584, or just go to DennisPrager.com. The book is up there, Marry Him, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough. So, look, you're a public person now, so are you getting married?
You will have to read the book.
I read the article, every single word. You're right. You're right. Absolutely right that this is absolutely worth reading. There's no doubt in my mind. Okay, that's fair enough. I'll live with that answer. If you do, I want to be invited to your wedding.
Deal.
Yeah, that was the, you're sure. Yeah, sure.
No, I mean it, Dennis. Deal. Deal. You wait for that invitation.
That's right. Absolutely. I want to make a toast. I think you've helped a lot of women. I'm not kidding. And therefore a lot of men. And that's a wonderful thing to be able to do in life. And let's see. Let me just read off some of the calls because of the time factor. Janice in San Antonio, at what age should we share this book with our daughters?
You know, I spoke to clergy for this book, too, and I said, you know, would you be giving this advice to a 31-year-old? I was 41 when I was asking him these questions. And he said, I would give it to a 21-year-old, all the more because they're dazzled by the things that won't matter.
I don't know why it shouldn't be given to a teenager.
Yeah.
To be perfectly honest. Michael in Texas also. Boy, Texas is calling in today. My wife has this problem with me. She thinks I want the Victoria's Secret model we see in the mall window. She needs to hear my CDs, Michael, on male sexual nature. let's see here. Steve in Dearborn, Michigan, finds this fascinating, and I thank you. Rebecca in Minneapolis, at 38, I made a list of characteristics for a husband. Married 22 years, I wasn't going to look for the superficial stuff. Well done, Rebecca. You should have written the book. Lori would have read it earlier. Well, listen, good luck to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
You're very welcome. You've done a service here. Again, the phone number at the Prager store, 800-225-8584 for this hour to subscribe. The book is up at DennisPrager.com. It shows the power of what I've argued on the happiness hour and on the male-female hour, how important it is for the mind to direct our lives. The mind versus the brain. The brain gets you in trouble. It says, eat the cheesecake. The mind says, it's not all that good for you. You're listening to The Dennis Prager Show, the male-female hour. Stay tuned for more.